Good evening, everyone. Congressional District 4 attendees. This is the State of the Census, a virtual town hall with Congressman Anthony Brown, Chairman Elizabeth Hewlett, and Chairman Harry Freeman. Our special guest for this evening is the United States Census Bureau, Common Cause, United Way, and Casa de Maryland. These are our valued partners. My name is Jordan Balcom Colbert, and I am your moderator for this evening. I serve as the 2020 Census Outreach Coordinator for Prince George's County's Complete Count Committee, and I am so excited to be a part of this engagement tonight. We work in partnership with the County Executive, Angela Olsobrooks, and the Office of Community Relations. We are together a great coordination team for Prince George's County. The purpose of this forum is to educate our community participants on why there's a sense of urgency to complete the 2020 census now more than ever. On March 12th, residents started to receive an invitation to respond to the 2020 census via mail. The current national self-response rates are 59.6%. For Maryland, it's 63.6%. For Anne Arundel County, it's 68.7%. And for Prince George's County, it's 60.7%. The self-response rates are reflective of residents that completed their 2020 census forms by mail, online, or via phone. I want to give a great congratulations to Anne Arundel County and Prince George's County for their tremendous outreach in helping each area and jurisdiction reach their threshold over 60%, which is really fantastic given the state of that we're in with COVID-19. They have worked diligently to make sure Congressional District 4 is truly represented. I would like to formally introduce our host for the evening, Congressman Anthony G. Brown. Congressman Brown represents Maryland District, Congressional District 4, which encompasses both Anne Arundel and Prince George's County since his initial election to Congress in 2016. Congressman Brown currently serves as Vice Chair of the House Armed Services Committee and as a member of several other House committees for Natural Resources, Ethics, Transportation, and Infrastructure. He was first elected to the Maryland House of Delegates representing Prince George's County in 1998 and later served as Lieutenant Governor from 2007 to 2015. A voice for veterans, Congressman Brown is a retired colonel in the United States Army Reserve with a military record spanning more than 25 years. We welcome Congressman Anthony Brown to our State of the Census in the Age of COVID-19 virtual town hall. Congressman Anthony Brown.
Well, thank you very much. And I apologize for coming in the way I did with my makeshift setup. Had some technical difficulties, but I think I'm with you now. Okay, so first of all, let me thank each and every one of you. I want to thank the team at the Census Bureau for the work that you're doing and certainly made more difficult with the pandemic that we're in and with the social distancing, the stay-in-place orders. But I want to thank you. I want to thank Betty Hewlett, who chairs our Complete Count Committee here in Prince George's County. Just everyone who's rolling up their sleeves and going to work. Look, there ought to be, and I know among so many, there is a true sense of urgency to get this count done, to get it accurately and in a timely way. I mean, the 2020 census is going to shape the allocation of more than $1.5 trillion to states over the next decade. And just to sort of, to give you a sense of what that means, in 2010 census, as a result of that, it allocated roughly $31 billion annually to Maryland. So the number's gonna be larger, and it's gonna be larger in large part but the fact that we're gonna do an accurate count. A fair and accurate and complete count will ensure that our communities have access to affordable and life-saving healthcare options, including Medicare and Medicaid, CHIP and other public health assistance. These funds support our hospitals and frontline healthcare workers, which we know today is so important. Federal dollars help improve our roads, our bridges, public health transportation systems, and they secure additional resources for our schools and educators and our students. These dollars ensure working families are supported through Social Security and SNAP and other safety net programs. And an accurate count ensures fair and proportional representation in Congress and throughout government. Each and every person, regardless of immigration status, counts in the census. Every low-income student who gets counted secures nearly $1,500 in federal education funding. An undercount of just 1% would result in the loss of $270,000 for education in our district, and that's equivalent to 1 year's worth of textbooks for more than 1,000 students. An undercount of just 1% would result in the loss of $223,000 in funding for jobs programs for our district. For the 2010 census, Maryland's 4th Congressional District, that was 10 years ago, had a 70.1 self-response rate. As of last Wednesday, our district, our self-response rate for the 2020 census was 61.4%. So we're behind. When we look at countywide responses to date, Prince George's County is at 60.1%. That's 14th in the state. We can do better. Anne Arundel County is 68.1%. That's 6th in the state. We can do better. Now, the national response rate is 59%, but we know in Prince George's County, we know in Maryland, that we always want to do well above national averages, national rates, because we want to lead and we know what it means for our communities. 2020 is the first year the census can be completed online at my2020census.gov. And each response that is done online is one less door that census workers have to knock on during this public health crisis. So completing the census is a civic duty that ensures our communities don't get left behind. Now, just real briefly, and let me wrap up with this. On Friday, Congress passed the HEROES Act, or I should say the House of Representatives did. We sent it to the Senate. In addition to all of the resources that we've already put into the census, what we did last week would include more than $400 million to conduct the census in the midst of the pandemic. It would provide additional oversight of the administration's reporting and census data collection. And it would include provisions to ensure that college and university students are properly counted. It builds on the $7.6 billion in census funding that Congress passed into law last year. And we also fought hard against the effort to include citizenship questions on the census because many of us believe that that would only serve to suppress the inaccurate count. So finally, let me just add by saying that my office stands ready to work with the Census Bureau, the counties, organizations like United Way, Common Cause, Casa de Maryland. We are here to support you and your outreach efforts, particularly as we reach out to traditionally undercounted and hard to reach populations, including those populations, many of them in our communities of color. So thank you for allowing me to participate. Pleased to be the host this evening. And I want to thank all the hardworking people that not just make this evening count, but that makes our census count and makes it work accurately. So thank you very much, and I'll yield back.
Thank you so much, Congressman Brown. We appreciate the very important message. Next, I will go on to introduce our county chairs, then I will go on to introduce our experts, and then we will get into Q&A. During the Q&A segment, please enter your questions via chat on the at the bottom of your screen, and we will also go over a few questions that were entered prior to during registration. I will introduce Chairman Elizabeth Hewlett. She is the Prince George's County Complete Count Committee Chair, and she was also appointed chairman for Prince George's County Planning Board in 2011 and 2013. She received her bachelor's degree from Tufts University and Juris Doctorate from Boston College of Law. Hewlett has extensive legal background in both public and private sectors and was recognized as one of the region's most 100 most powerful women by the Woman magazine and top 100 women in Maryland, and his most influential Marylanders for the Daily Record. Chairman Hewlett, and then I will introduce Chairman Harry Freeman. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I am so pleased to be here today and to participate. And I got to give a shout out and a huge thank you to Congressman Anthony Brown. I'm so pleased that you have scheduled this and hosted this event. And it's because it's so important that we get the census information out and that we up our counts throughout the state. Right now, as chair of the Prince George's County Census Complete Count Committee, I'm concerned about the county in particular, but of all of our counties in the state of Maryland. So I was asked to provide some of the updates and some of the things that we're doing. Our Complete Count Committee started off with a bang. It is an all hands on deck with elected officials, stakeholders. We had over 100 committee members, and we have 13 subcommittees, and it's just been fabulous. And we had block parties, we had interviews, we've done everything under the sun, and then COVID hit. So we had to just rearrange and change the way we thought about things, but we are not letting that stop us. So we've had over 250 community events pre-census, but since then, we are working on meal distribution. These are just some of the examples that we do. And when we do meal distribution, which we do every single day in Prince George's County, the county government, the county exec's office, the Office of Community Relations, the county council, and Park and Planning Commission is doing it every day. And we provide census information to the communities as we pass out the food distribution. We've had a robust social media campaign as well. We've had over 500,000 impressions, so that's wonderful as well. We've had paid social media advertisements. The county executive, Angela Olsel-Brooks, has had her what's the 311 instead of what's the 411, the 311, where she talks about a number of different things, but including highlighting census and her town hall meetings that she has weekly, which have at least 61,000 participants. We're using the 311 text messaging to all county residents. We've had significant media engagement, and we're doing interviews. Even today, we had an interview with the African American newspaper. We've engaged the faith-based community and all of our stakeholders. We had a wonderful, big, fun census meetup with Joe Clare from WPGC, and we had so many participants, big fun, engendering so much excitement about the census. We had the census art break that the Office of Community Relations spearheaded, and where families got to demonstrate what census meant to them and why it's important, and via artwork, and that's very creative, but also very, very important. We have weekly virtual events, including the Take 10 for a Healthy Community. We're targeting outreach to the hard to reach and hard to count areas, which with response rates of less than 40%. We do daily monitoring of our census responses, which has now reached for Prince George's County 60.7%. We've printed census door hangers and yard signs, and many of us are putting up the yard signs so as people drive by, you can still see the importance of census. The planning department created a yeoman's effort with updating the addresses. And so we updated over 41,000 addresses to make sure that the census forms were sent to the right place, to the right names. And so that's been wonderful as well. And we've been working with the judiciary, and they've got signs all over the courthouse, and working with the juries and what have you too, to make sure that every juror comes in there knows about the importance of census. The fraternities and sororities all involved, even my own, I must say. And we just want everyone to stay up to date and volunteer with the Prince George's Census activity via pgcensus2020.org. Time won't permit me to go into all of what we do, but suffice it to say, it's an all hands on deck approach, because we are Prince George's County proud, and we are proud to be counted. Thank you. Thank you so much. We have wonderful partners too. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Chairman Hewlett. I will now move forward to introduce Chairman Harry Freeman. He is the chairman of Anne Arundel County's Complete Count Committee. He received his bachelor's in political science and master's in science and intelligent management. He currently attends Johns Hopkins University. He proudly served the United States Army Military Intelligence Branch and currently lives in Pasadena, Maryland with his 5-year-old son, Harvey. Chairman Freeman.
Hey, good evening, everyone. So what you heard from Chairman Hewlett is not far off from what Anne Arundel County is doing on our own accord. We're doing very similar processes that all the counties across Maryland are doing. So not to reiterate her accomplishments and achievements, I'll go ahead and go down a different route for giving some information about what's going on with the census at the county level. So to no one's surprise, our current social environment is not business as usual. We've got a once in a century pandemic butting heads with a once in a decade census. Now, interestingly, both of these events disproportionately affect the most vulnerable populations in our communities. In regards to the census, historically, it's our most marginalized and vulnerable people that go underrepresented in Congress, in our state legislatures, and even at the local level levels of our government. Here in Anne Arundel County, we have identified these communities both demographically and geographically to make sure we educate and motivate our fellow residents to be part of this snapshot. Snapshot's a word that the census uses all the time. This is our moment to give the best picture moving forward, to give the proper projections over the course of the next decade. So this snapshot of our community is very important for those very reasons. Our immigrant communities, our non-English speaking populations, our veteran population. As Jordan, our moderator, just mentioned, I'm a veteran. Congressman Brown is a veteran also. During my active service here in Fort Meade, Maryland, my home of record was still in Miami, Florida. It's imperative that we tell our veteran community that although your home of record may not be in Prince George's County, in Anne Arundel County, or even in the state of Maryland, you certainly reside here most often during your time of service here. You utilize our public schools, you utilize our resources, utilize hospitals when you need them, our public safety officials. Every single part of your life is rooted here in Maryland. So the veteran population is very important to take part in the census. Jordan also mentioned that I have a 5-year-old son. He is in a hard to count demographic of children 0 to 5 years of age. We have to remember that although we are the adults of the household, we need to count every single living person within our homes. Our friends and neighbors that are at or below the poverty line are also at a great risk of not being counted in the census and therefore being underrepresented. So for the past year, Anne Arundel County's Complete Count Committee has been hard at work to close these gaps and get people counted. Since COVID-19, we haven't stopped reaching out to our residents. Anne Arundel County Public Schools, I'm very proud to say, we passed the million meal milestone about a week ago through our efforts with our meal distribution sites to residents who need them. In addition to that, our school system has also given away 5,000 Chromebooks, over 5,000 Chromebooks, to families that don't have the capability to engage in the distance learning that we've had to experience. So understanding these metrics have augmented our approach to reach people in mass numbers. Our current action of note is the distribution of 83,000 flyers to our 40 school meal distribution areas, our 20 mobile meal distribution sites, grocery stores, and other high traffic areas that have been caused by the spread of COVID-19. So as was mentioned before, Anne Arundel County is ahead of the curve for the state, for the country, for the legislative district. But until we count everyone once, only once, and in the right place, we still have much room to improve. So that 68.7% might be fantastic to speak about now, but we have until October 31st to get these questionnaires submitted. So thank you, Congressman Brown. Thank you to all of our partners. Thank you for the collaboration with Prince George's County. All of us are excited to carry on this meeting, and we're eager to hear your questions. Thank you, folks.
Thank you so much, Chairman Freeman. We appreciate your partnership and your updates and report. Next segment we will go into is the introduction of the guest speakers. I will introduce and share information about each speaker, and then we will have each say a brief 5-minute update as it relates to the population most impacted within their outreach and their audience. So our first speaker is United States Census Bureau Representative Thomas Coogan. He's the Assistant Regional Census Manager for the state of Maryland for the census, and he is a lifelong resident of the state of Maryland. Rosie Allen Herring is the President and Chief Executive Officer for United Way of the National Capital Area. She is a national expert on private partnerships in philanthropy and business and has over 30 years of experience. Julia De Carmen Alves Zavala is a canvasser with Casa de Maryland and has been a proud volunteer with Casa de Maryland since 2016. She is a social worker and currently a student at UMBC with a double major in psychology and social work. Our next expert is Joanne Antoine. She is the Executive Director of Common Cause and has been with Common Cause since 2017. Joanne is has a long history as an organizer, a trainer, a strategist for numerous campaigns in the United States and also in Haiti. Joanne holds a bachelor's degree in English pre-law and has a master's in public policy. Welcome, experts. Again, each expert will speak briefly for 5 minutes. We will have questions at the end of the expert segment, and I will call your name upon completion of each expert. Thomas Coogan, thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Yes, this is Tom Coogan. And on behalf of our regional director, Fernando Armstrong, I want to thank the congressman and all of the sponsors and partners for inviting us to the forum. I also wanted to take time to thank the Complete Count committees represented here and all the hard work that they've put in reaching out to our various communities in an attempt to get everyone counted. You guys do a phenomenal job. Wanted to touch on some operational timeline items. I know there are some few questions around some of this. Since we did go into an operational pause in mid-March, some of our operations have changed, as you're well aware, but just to briefly touch on a few items. The self-response phase has been extended until October 31st. Our group quarters operation, which includes enumeration at transitory locations and service-based enumeration, has been extended to September 3rd, while the in-person group quarters enumeration will begin on July 1st. With that, we continue to work with group quarters, colleges, and universities on e-response. There's also an operational pause on the military enumeration during COVID, and that's based on DOD requests. As far as enumeration at transitory locations and service-based enumeration, there are no dates yet for that, but we're hoping to have that soon. Their headquarters is working and reviewing on that. The mobile questionnaire assistance is still under review and may become, as a lot of things have during this time, may become more of a virtual operation, but that is still being worked on as well. As far as the non-response follow-up, where we actually go out and enumerate those folks we have not received a return from as of yet, that is going to run from August 11th to October 31st. So trying to keep it brief, we know that there's still plenty of hard work to do. The Census Bureau, I'm confident, will be ready to meet that challenge by hiring the folks in the neighborhoods that they'll be working, that where they live. And I'm sure that the folks on this call, the Complete Count committees and those interested in a complete census will be up for the challenge as well. So Jordan, I'll refer that back to you.
Thank you so much, Tom, for your brief updates for the Bureau. I'm sure we have a lot of other questions that we'll get at a little bit later in this segment. The next speaker is Rosie Allen Herring. Thank you, Rosie.
Thank you, Jordan. And thank you also to Congressman Brown, as well as all of our chair, both Chairwoman Hewlett and Chairman Freeman. I am Rosie Allen Herring, and it is a pleasure to be with you this evening. And this is one of the most important topics that we can certainly share and have this dialogue. And I look forward to hearing the questions from all of our participants this evening. But it really is about, at the end of the day, many people tend to think of the census as a very political issue. It depends on what side of the fence you're on. It depends on whether or not you feel like you've been disenfranchised, or whether or not you want to be counted, hard to count, or not wanting to be counted. I want to encourage you to think of this not as a political issue. This is an equity issue. This is a fairness issue. And this is how we all ensure that our voices are heard. You can't be heard if you can't be counted. And so as you're going back to all of our participants on this call, to your respective homes, to your respective businesses, to your respective organizations, make certain that we share that there should be no fear in making certain that you are counted, because everyone's voice matters and everyone needs to be counted. Now, it's one thing to say that we want everybody to be counted. It's another thing to say why it's so important. And it's so important because when you look at the grand scheme of things, there is over $675 billion, annually, every single year, that is distributed throughout this country. And it is distributed by the census. That is a determinant of how much your area, your county, your state gets. And for this Washington metropolitan region, that's over $24 billion. And so that is no small number, but that number will get smaller if everyone isn't counted. And what happens to those dollars? Why are those dollars so important? Why do we need to make certain that they're counted? Because that determines how many schools you have, your hospitals, the ability to be able to build schools, the number of representation that you have in Congress. It's a plethora of reasons. And so I know that maybe some on the panelists here, and certainly those who are on this call, who understand the significance of it. They're here to try to look for solutions as to how we can help people not, especially those who are hard to be counted, to be counted. Your United Way is here to stand in that gap with you in partnership with the county, as well as with both counties, but also in partnership with my congressman, and Congressman Brown is my congressman, and to make certain that at the end of the day, all of our fellow citizens and neighbors have the opportunity to be able to share their voice and be counted. So there are a couple of things that I know that are going on. And again, we've talked about those who are hard to reach. They may be some of various immigration, nationalities that may or may not want to be counted. We recognize that the climate in this country right now is at an all-time fever pitch when it comes to racial issues, but this is not the time to shrink from that. This is the time to make certain that we are counted, because this is a country that is based on demographics, and this is a country that was built on diversity. And so at the end of the day, it is nothing wrong with being counted. It's nothing wrong with sharing who you are, and you don't have to worry about what that looks like. It's just a matter of making certain you make yourself available. Also making certain, as Chairman Freeman shared, that you count literally everybody. Don't worry about it seeming like it's too many, whether or not someone's gonna judge you in your home by who's there. I don't care if they're there temporarily. I don't care if they're there on their way to somewhere else. If they're there for the moment that you're doing that census, we need you to count them. We also need to make certain that when we look at our census, that's a way of also looking at how our wages are being counted and how our wages are being distributed amongst all of our workers. If we don't count our low-income workers or those who are dealing with low wealth or poverty challenges, we will never know how big that population is. And the bigger the population, of course, we know then that's the voice that gets the need. And so we want to make certain that we're able to bring all of that to the forefront. There is absolutely no issue that is off limits when we're talking about the census, because this is the time, and it only happens every 10 years, when everything is on the table. And so I want to encourage all of our organizations, especially those who work with many of our neighbors who may not want to be counted, don't think that they matter, to ensure that they know that they do. We want you to know about the all of the various things that you can do. I know one of the things that my colleagues at United Way, and I have I think, the best colleagues in the world, because they allow me to be with you, but they do a lot of this work. And so I know two of them are on this call this evening. Nadelka Phillips, who is our Vice President of Marketing and Communications, who really does a phenomenal job of doing a lot of our outreach and helping us tell and shape a story around why it's so important. I do want you to go to the United Way website. We have a phenomenal video, if you have not seen it, that really talks about why it's so important to be counted. And then there are other things that are going on as well. My other colleague, Lavina Kim, who has been our census coordinator for our entire organization, literally across all three jurisdictions, DC, Maryland, and Virginia. And Lavina has helped us come up with innovative ways to reach the community. And one of those ways is also what we call our census art breaks. And every Friday for until now, until the end of the month, for about 20 minutes, we have a census art break where you can go to YouTube and paint with kids to allow your kids to be distracted for just about 20 minutes when we think it'll take parents about 10 to fill out that census, and give yourselves another 10-minute break before you go back to homeschooling and all that you're doing with the kids. But I just want to leave you with a couple of thoughts. It's really an ask. Someone asks, is there an ask? Yes, there is an ask of you. The ask is that you make certain that in every venue that you're in, you make certain that all of your neighbors, all of your colleagues, all of those that you work with, make certain every church that you go to, any environment that you're in, that you ask everyone that you're around whether or not they filled out their census. If they have not, if there is a question, if they're unsure, if they don't believe that they're tech savvy, we ask that you make the time to be with them to help them get through that particular journey. It is not long, it is not cumbersome, but if someone is fearful of it, we need you to help alleviate that fear so that they can be counted. We already know the implications of not counting. We want to make certain that we find every way that we can to reach everyone to allow them to make certain that they're counted. Again, $24 billion is what comes to this region when we are accurately counted. And that $24 billion is based on a number that's 10 years ago. We know that nothing is the same as it was 10 years ago. So that $24 billion likely needs to be probably doubled. And the only way that we're going to be able to advocate for that is to ensure that our numbers are larger and higher than they were 10 years ago, and to make certain that all of our fellow citizens are counted. So again, I look forward to having the dialogue and look forward to hearing even more of the questions. And I thank all of the other panelists who are here working in the community on the ground every day serving families. And again, we thank the county executive for her leadership, as well as our two co-chairs this evening. Thank you so much for the opportunity to share.
Thank you so much, Rosie. United Way is definitely a proud partner of our census team. And so I'm going to move on to Casa de Maryland with Julia De Carmen Alves Zavala. Thank you, Julia.
Hi, everybody. So as Jordan introduced me, my name is Julia, and I am a proud census canvasser with CASA. For about half a year now, CASA has been working day and night, honestly, to make sure that Prince George's and as well as Montgomery County is being counted here in Maryland. And so we've done a million things, honestly. Before COVID came about, we were able to do a lot more. We knocked on over 12,000 doors. We held over 3,000 face-to-face conversations and collected over 2,100 census pledge cards, just stating that people did want to pledge to fill out the census. And since then, we have moved into more a phone banking kind of setup, in which we call back all the people that we've already spoken to face-to-face and help them fill out the census as best we can, and providing them information such as websites where they can go fill out the census, the phone numbers they can call. And the majority of the community members that we are working with are undocumented and Spanish speaking. So that holds a lot of barriers on its own. More than anything, the technological kind of barriers where they feel not sufficient enough to be able to navigate it on their own. We often remind them, if you have Facebook, if you have WhatsApp, it's as easy as navigating those platforms. And these websites are in many, many languages, including Spanish. And so we're definitely making sure that our immigrant community knows how important it is for them to be counted in a state where they might feel right now that maybe they don't have a say or they are not entitled to any benefits. This is where they are. I always tell members when I speak with them that the law doesn't state that the census is counting people who have citizenship or status. It's counting people who reside in this country. So if they reside in this country, they have a right to be counted. And so we are always making sure that they know that and that these funds are coming to support them and their families in so many ways, from healthcare facilities to educational resources in schools to the streets that we drive and walk on. So we make sure that they know that this funding might not come directly into their pockets, but it is being seen in their daily, everyday lives. And so we have definitely been able to lessen the fear, especially since there is no question about immigration status on the census. We ensure them that the government will not be knowing their status. They are not at any risk in filling it out. They're only bringing beneficial resources to their county, to their city that they live in and reside in, and that this is a one in a 10-year chance that they have to do this, because that's just how the census works. And a lot of the people that I do encounter when either on the phone or prior in person, they might not have known what the census was, not knowing the importance. And again, being fearful more than anything because of immigration status. And our job in CASA has always been to make sure that anything that we are promoting or anything that we are wanting our community members to engage in is 100% safe for them. This includes the census. So I would definitely just ask for anybody who is here on the call right now to ensure that their neighbors, that is completely safe to fill out the census, whether you have a legal immigration status or not, and that there are so many resources in various languages. In the Prince George's County, we also encountered people who didn't speak Spanish. They might have spoken a native tongue. And so there is definitely such a great help at the Census Bureau to make sure that everybody can reach the census and filling it out as easy as possible. And again, as has been stated over and over again, the once in 10-year chance that we do get to do this, it is so crucial that we are all counted. And as previously also stated, the numbers that were there 10 years ago are much higher than they were and now. And so the majority of those people, a lot of them are also undocumented immigrants, and just knowing that all these people that are coming in, whether they came in 9, 10, even a month ago, that they have the right to be counted. Whether they came to the city a day ago, they have a right to be counted, because this is where they reside. This is their home.
Thank you so much, Julia. I appreciate your comments. You are definitely, Casa de Maryland is definitely a proud census partner in our outreach initiative. I'm going to move on forward to comments and join Antoine. Thank you, Joanne.
Thank you. So good evening, everyone. And thank you to Congressman Brown, Prince George's County, and Anne Arundel County for having us on today. For those who aren't familiar with Common Cause Maryland, we are a nonpartisan watchdog group that has been working in the state and throughout the country for just about 50 years now, working to ensure that our elected and appointed officials are working on behalf of the public's best interest, and that you all are able to have your voices heard in the political process. And that means being able to have your voice heard in the census first. So we have been working to ensure that the census is fair and that the count is as accurate as possible. Some of that work dates back months ago from, you know, fighting off these risks of a census or citizenship question, fighting for fair funding. Here in the state, we supported efforts to establish a statewide complete count committee and currently serve on that committee, working to ensure that, you know, communities like immigrant communities and other language communities have the resources and that outreach is being done to them. And more importantly, during COVID-19, we have been working to track the changes and the overall impacts that they're gonna have over the next 10 years, I should say. So one important point I did want to flag as we're thinking about COVID-19 and just knowing that everyone is scared right now, right? And that you are thinking about the health of your family members and your friends and so forth, that we also need to continue to think about the health of our democracy. You know, we're thinking about hospitals right now, and we're talking a lot about PPE and whether or not there are enough supplies in place. All of these things are directly coordinated or directly tied to census data. And we, you know, if anything, if you leave here today, making sure that you're counted ensures that if there is ever a crisis like this again, that there are enough resources and that they're distributed in an equitable way in all neighborhoods. So again, these resources determine, you know, these resources ensure that they're, or the data ensures that resources are distributed equitably, that there's fair government representation. It also helps us determine the number of congressional districts that we'll have here in Maryland, as well as our voting districts. And as you all know, COVID-19 has led to a number of delays. Even when we're looking at the enumeration process, that's now been moved to the summer. The appropriations process has been delayed and so forth. And all of this is going to impact the redistricting processes all throughout the country. I know that the Bureau more recently asked for a 4-month delay on when this data would be sent to the states. Now, just to give you a sense of when this data would typically come in, it would have been sent to Maryland around March of 2021. This now means that the data would, there's a possibility that this data would now be coming to us as late as July 31st, 2021. That might not sound alarming, but when you're looking at states like New Jersey and Virginia, who have off-year elections, right? All of these things will impact them, and it's going to either have to lead them to delaying their elections or moving the deadlines that they have in place. Now, Maryland, thankfully, our deadline is a bit different. It's behind. Our deadline is mid-February 2022. This is going to be the 45th day during the legislative session. So we do have some time. But again, historically, when you're looking at Maryland and our redistricting processes and so forth, this leaves us very little time to ensure that the redistricting process is done in a fair and equitable way. So again, Common Cause Maryland, other organizations, our partners, specifically the League of Women Voters, will be continuing to watch how the changes are going to impact our redistricting process as we go into 2021, 2022. But you right now, if you are watching from home, the most important thing that you need to do for the census, for the overall health of our democracy, is making sure that you're counted today. Understanding that your count in the census impacts our voting rights and so forth. And with elections right around the corner, you should be doing both, right? Vote by mail and then go online and fill out your form as well. So I'll pause there, and I'm happy to answer questions towards the end about our redistricting process.
Thank you so much, Joanne. Again, another valued partner in our census outreach initiative with Common Cause. Redistricting is very important, just as important as voting. So we just want to make sure we place that reference for our listeners. We're going to move on into our Q&A segment. We have several questions out there for our panelists. Some are relevant to each organization, and some are more general. So when I say that they're more general, panelists, please feel free to jump in and answer those questions. At the top of the mark is a question from one of our former prior questions that we had. How is outreach being conducted to keep social distancing protocols in mind? And so I think that's an open question for all of the panelists. However, if we could just have the Bureau, start with the Bureau, how are protocols for social distancing pairing with your operational outreach? How are you preparing with that? And if you can answer that in half a minute, and then we would like to hear some from some of the other panelists in terms of COVID-19 outreach, perhaps Anne Arundel County or Prince George's County, how we're doing with that, coping with that.
Yes, thank you, Jordan. This is Tom Coogan with the Census. Two things. One would be our partnership team in Maryland is doing an excellent job working remotely, virtually, as all of us are. and they hopefully are readily available to help anyone on this call in order to conduct outreach the best remote virtual way possible. The second quick thing would be within our offices. Our offices are not fully open at this point. With our staff and operationally, we will absolutely be mindful of social distancing with whatever operation that we are involved in. So I'll refer that back to you, Jordan.
Okay, thank you. Does one of our counties want to address how we are dealing with social distancing protocols and still getting our outreach done?
I'd like to jump in. This is Betty Hewlett, the chair of the Prince George's Census Complete Count Committee. Mostly virtual. We have virtual town halls. And as I said, the county executive's town hall has over 61,000 participants. That's weekly. We're doing social media blasts. We're doing paid social media as well, advertisements as well. Just as Rosie Allen Herring said, we talked about the art break and so many other different things that we're doing to get the word out. And the most imperative thing is that we lost $363 million in the 2010 census because it was $18,250 per person that was not counted. And that money goes to, and this is the thing we're really trying to get across to people, that money goes to so many different things like Snapchat, WIC and so many other things, but it's imperative in COVID because knowing the number of people in an individual neighborhood, for instance, will help that people understand how many vaccines are needed in that area, what kind of hospitals that we need. So we're doing so many creative things and to make sure that we tie it into this COVID crisis, to make sure that people understand that while there's so many other things on your plate, as has already been indicated, you still have to make sure that we complete that census. So we're asking everyone, we've been on the radio, we're asking everyone to tell their friends so that their friends can tell people, wherever you are, make sure your family, every single person in your circle you ought to be talking to make sure that they complete their census. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Chairman Hewlett. The next question is, how are we reaching our seniors, our nursing facilities, and our college students? I believe this is a great question for the Census Bureau as well.
Oh, sorry about that, Jordan. As far as colleges, we are working with most of the colleges and universities on what's called an electronic response, e-response. That has been held up a little bit. A lot of the schools aren't fully staffed. However, we are taking a look at, headquarters is taking a look at the surrounding areas around the school to formulate some plan in order to capture those. As we know, there are quite a few folks that live off campus. But the on-campus should be completed with the e-response, and that should be happening within the next 6 weeks.
Okay, thank you so much. So I have a question. If you have, so we have a viewer that says that they have completed their census form twice, they believe, one via online and one by paper form. Will one be discarded? How do you all manage duplicates at the Census Bureau?
Okay, that there is a deduplicating department, believe it or not, that goes over. We receive all forms. We take all forms in. They go through and they manage that. Since this is basically an address-based census, once we see multiple entries from one address, then someone reviews that for the to eradicate any duplications.
Thank you. This is a great question for Casa de Maryland. How are we reaching our Latino population and that community in terms of census outreach in the midst of COVID-19 and also with regards to job loss? How are we reaching them to make sure the message is sound in the midst of COVID-19?
That's a great question. So yeah, as I previously stated, we did get to get in touch with a lot of people door knocking prior to COVID hitting. So we're really grateful for all those efforts that our canvassers had the chance to do, as well as our organizers. And so from the information of the people that we've already reached, we are calling them back and ensuring that they are filling out the census, providing them information. We personally cannot help them fill it out just to protect their privacy. We are then giving them resources such as the website where they can go to. A lot of our immigrant population community members are Spanish speaking, so we provide them already with a link that leads them to the census website in Spanish. We also provided them with phone numbers where they can reach help centers of the census with people who speak Spanish or English. And so that's how we're making sure that they are filling it out. And we are calling them not once, but twice to ensure that maybe they've forgotten that they are staying on top of it. And just also letting, if they have any concerns, that we can definitely help them as best we can. Amidst everything that is happening, we do have a lot of members that have unfortunately lost their jobs, who have now been, are now finding themselves in financial kind of crisis situations. And it can be a bit of a struggle for them and a bit frustrating when you know, the census does provide funds on behalf of the government for our communities in a time right now where they feel that they are not being seen by the government to receive aid and to receive funds. It can be frustrating, but we're reminding them that the funds that do come to the community still benefit them. It's still benefiting their children who are attending public schools. It's still affecting right now health facilities that they have always and do have the right to attend, whether they have status or not. And all the benefits, as Ms. Hewlett said, sorry, that you know, these numbers and these funds are coming to then now know how many vaccines we need, how many you know, beds we need in our facilities, how many new facilities we might need. And so there is just like a plethora of reasons still to give our community members, reminding them that yes, you know, right now these times are tough, and we are struggling, but the funds are still coming. And at the end of the day, they're still coming to benefit us, to ensure that our community has enough resources to support all of our members in whatever ways are needed.
Thank you so much. I think you answered a two-part question that we had, which was, you answered how it's impacting the Latino community, but you also reference as to why the census is important and how can we be so sure, which was one of the questions, how can we be so sure that the money, our federal funds, is going to trickle down to our community? As we can see during the COVID-19, it's impacting many communities and some aren't so sure. Well, is the census really trickling down? So you hit it right on the nail that vaccination, emergency services, and healthcare play a big factor in that. While I still have CASA on the line, can you please share how many people can get in contact with you to conduct phone calls? That was one of the questions posed. Participants want to know how they can help their immigrant and international communities.
Right. So thank you so much to the community that wants to help us out. And so in that, I would have to then pass on the information of my superior supervisor to then direct you guys, which I can put in the chat. I can put down their information so as to reach out to them. As of right now, our census canvassers have already been like selected. And as I also said, we are not trying to help fill out the census step by step, again, to protect the members' information. We don't want their information to be spread out and not be private. And so I can just put that information in the chat. And more than anything, just continue to spread the word about the how safe it is to fill out the census, so that your neighbors know that it is safe. If your neighbors are undocumented, let them know that you filled it out, and you know that how easy it was, or you know that there are other resources if you don't understand, you know, that you can call or that you can visit online.
Thank you so much. I'm going to give a few more questions because I know I want to stay within time. We started about 10 minutes late, but I'll try to wrap it up with Q&A in the next 2 minutes. But I want to get out another question, and this one is for the Bureau. The Bureau is hot right now. It's very popular in questions. So for the Bureau, for Tom Coogan, job opportunities. Where are we with job opportunities? And for people that have already applied, when will they receive follow-up, and or how's the operations going in terms of the COVID-19 impact? So if you can give us a brief update in terms of where we are with jobs. Thank you.
Absolutely. Yes, since we are in our pause, we really have not made very many selections, if any, of either enumerators or office staff. Once June 1st comes around, we should be more free to continue. Group quarters enumeration will be the first up, and we will be selecting some additional enumerators for training in June. As we mentioned, July 1st starts in the field with that. But I would encourage folks to still apply. We've got a tremendous response. As a matter of fact, Prince George's County is over 200% of the goal for the census for the county, which is fabulous. But we need to encourage everyone, especially in some of the more hard to count areas, to apply, because we're going to be needing the folks that live in those neighborhoods to actually do the work for the census as a trusted voice.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. And before I go on to our last question of the evening, I want to make sure that our panelists are seeing questions from our audience. If you get a chance to jump in and answer a question, you click on their name and it'll respond to that individual and all of the panelists and all of the attendees, because unfortunately we're not going to be able to go through everyone this evening, but I want to make sure that the panelists have some type of engagement with our attendees. And so if you can have a moment to hop in and answer questions, that would be really helpful. Our last question of the evening will be, give me 1 second. So if we could just highlight really quickly, because it seems like this question is coming up a lot from the Census Bureau. Can you please just reiterate a few things for us in terms of operations? One, when did the census start? When does it end? And secondly, what is an enumerator and a census taker? If you can kind of identify and give a definition to both of those terms, that would be helpful so we can have a response for the audience.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, the enumerator census taker is basically the same position. The census taker is more of a community term. Enumerator is more of an operational Census Bureau term. And as we've mentioned, the census is ongoing. It's going on right now. Folks are calling. Folks are responding online. And those folks who have received a paper form are responding that way also. The census enumeration, accounting of the non-respondents beginning in August will run through October 31st. So that would be the cutoff time as we have it right now. So hopefully that answers that set of questions, Jordan.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you. And so in the essence of time, we are going to move on to our last segment. This is going to be a call to action from our county, our complete count committee chairs, Chairman Freeman and Chairman Hewlett, will give a brief call to action. We will do a brief polling to see how many residents have completed their census forms. And if you can, for the audience, tell 5 family members or friends to complete the census today. And then we'll close out with Congressman Anthony Brown, which will all take about less than 5 minutes. Chairman Freeman, if you could proceed with a call to action for Anne Arundel County, and then Chairman Hewlett for Prince George's County.
Absolutely. So thank you again for all your questions. Thank you again for all these wonderful answers to everyone. Call to action real quick is every single opportunity that we've had to conduct a field campaign has shifted. So now more than ever, we are requiring more volunteers to assist us where we can. We need to spread ourselves a lot more thinly. Much of our members are members of the county government, our public service officers, and they are wearing multiple hats right now to deal with all of this pandemic. So if we can get volunteers in Prince George's County, get volunteers in Anne Arundel County to assist at meal distribution sites, to assist at the immobile sites, to assist in just getting the word out. There are, at this moment, 118 participants still with us on the call. Social media is free. You all have access to your own little universe, and any way that you can help us promote the census right now, today, to get our friends and neighbors to complete this is something that we all will greatly appreciate. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to echo Chairman Freeman's, because he did such a spectacular job. It's imperative that we spread the word and that we tell everybody, and using every avenue that's available to you, because the thing that you have to remember is if we are undercounted, we will be underserved on every level, in Congress, and every level, financially, in terms of the supplies that are needed, our first responders, our hospitals, our beds, our vaccines, in every conceivable way. So it's imperative that we are counted, and if we are not counted, we will be underserved. However, I have tremendous faith in Prince Georgians. I have tremendous faith in all of us. And I know that all hands on deck, faith-based community, everybody on this call, everybody who's listening, we're gonna go back to your spheres. And with all hands on deck, we will rise to the occasion and we will do this. I say this all the time, I'm going to hit the county executive's mantra. We are Prince George's proud, and we are proud to be counted. It's imperative. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Chairman Hewlett. We are now going to do the polling briefly, give you all 1 minute to answer the polling briefly. The first question that will present itself is, have you completed your 2020 census? And the second polling will ask, can you commit to telling 5 family members or friends to complete their census forms today? Host and panelists cannot vote. So, just for our attendees, thank you. And so, Joanne, let us know when we can move forward to close out. Mm-hmm. We can move forward.
We're still on the first question. It looks like people are still answering.
Okay.
Okay, we'll end it here. We have 60. People are still answering.
That's good.
Like an overwhelming number of individuals have already completed their census. So right now, 71 folks have responded, 65 have completed it so far, only 6 haven't. So the 6, if you need help, feel free to drop your names in the chat and the local CCCs will reach out to you. And the second question should pop up for everyone right now.
Will you commit to calling 5 people to encourage them to complete their census? This is really important, family, because while there may be undercounted areas that we have a hard time messaging, our family and friends who are used to completing their census forms are going through a lot right now. So it helps for you to give them a call, to give them a little nudge and let them know that in the midst of all of the chaos, that completing their census forms is most imperative today.
Okay, and I'm ending the poll. It looks like an overwhelming number of folks have said that they'll make calls. We're gonna hold you all to it. 64 folks have said they're making a commitment today to make calls. 4 said they can't, but I hope that if you don't make calls, you can tweet, right? Or share a post saying that you've completed yours and here's how to do it as well. So that poll should have just ended for everyone.
Great. Thank you so much, Joanne. And so I'm going to end before I hand it off to Congressman Brown, but I wanted to let you all know, although we didn't answer all of your questions, you have very important ballot questions. Please reach out to us at pgcensus2020 at mnppc.org. There we can answer any questions you have, but we'll do a follow-up email so that we can share these questions or get the contact information you need for both counties, both Anne Arundel and Prince George's County. And my name is Jordan Balcom Colbert, and I'm your moderator for the evening. And it was my pleasure to serve you and participate. And thank you so much to Congressman Brown's office. We appreciate you, and thank you for helping us close out.
Great. Well, first of all, let me say thank you, Jordan, for hosting this evening's event. You did it brilliantly, and I appreciate that. Want to once again thank our complete count committee chairs. I had mentioned Betty Hewlett at the beginning of the call, but I also want to give a shout out and a big thanks to Harry Freeman in Anne Arundel County and the work that you're doing. Thank you to our panelists, not just for being on this evening, but what you're doing in your respective organizations and in the community to ensure that we get a complete count. Tom at the Census Bureau, Rosie at United Way, Julia at Casa de Maryland, and Joanne at Common Cause. Look, this is a big year, 2020, right? Two big counts, right? One is your vote, and your vote counts. We've got a primary in Maryland June 2nd, and then an election in November. So your vote counts, but you count. And making sure that we count ourselves. I think it's a reflection of a sense of self-worth, pride, self-dignity and respect in what we think about ourselves in a community. When you express yourself through the count, responding to the survey, encouraging our neighbors to count, we're saying a lot about our community. And yes, there are federal dollars to be gained. And yes, it ensures that we have the, you know, adequate representation in government. But at the end of the day, it's about us standing up, taking pride, and saying, hey, we count. We count as individuals. We're in our community. Our community counts. So thanks for being on the call, and thanks for what you're doing to make sure that every vote and every person counts. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone. That concludes our town hall for the evening. Again, please feel free to reach out to us with any further questions you might have. And thank you so much to our panelists and our experts. Until we meet again, stay safe and healthy. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.